Wow. Are you ready for even bigger wows? Absolutely. Yesterday was the most incredible day. In the evening, I was just extremely tired. The stress and the strain of you know, storming the top of the mountain just laid me out, and I didn't get much sleep last night, but I'm okay this morning. I'm still tired and shaky, but that's the price you pay for storming the top of the mountain. I mean, you push into really rarefied air, and the climatization, you know, you feel the strain for sure. But I'm fine. I'm absolutely fine. No troubles at all. Ready for another push today. I don't know how much I have in me. Yesterday was really, but I'll give it everything I got right here. Keep in mind that the spiritual path, very simple. It's simply that you are acclimatizing yourself to incredibly great news. The news is so wonderful, that you have to bit by bit, gradually get used to it. That is the spiritual path right there. It's not anything other than that. The news is absolutely tremendous. Now, especially in this dense realm of condensed light, it feels as though there's extreme preferences for spaciousness. It seems to be presenting extreme preferences for form, right? For appearances here. So it is very difficult to get this news here, down here into this realm of condensed light. The mood of this place is supremely skeptical. Supremely skeptical here, okay? This is true, all right. There's no point in denying that. This is the place that breeds skepticism. This is the place where the hardcore skeptics come. This is their abode. This is their lair. This is where they hide out, they hang out, and so the mood of this world is profoundly materialistic, profoundly skeptical, profoundly spiritually dualistic, and so it is not easy to accept this good news here. It seems to fly in the face. You're swimming against the current here, So what I'd like to say is the best we can do, most people can do, if you're here to really help, is to help people get to maybe here. Help this realm get to maybe. That's a huge shift, actually. Now you can tell in this world there's a massive push to get rid of maybe here. Maybe has been here in this world. Maybe is what you need. So maybe is what everybody needs. And by maybe I say maybe there really is some great news. Maybe I better start getting used to that, getting familiar with that. Maybe I need to do that. That's all. In this realm, getting to maybe is the crucial step. Many here, I don't want to, seem not to want to get to maybe, but that can change. This world is so hardcore into turning away from the great good news, believing that spaciousness has preferences. Okay, believing in that. This is the place where that belief is so strong, so intense, So of course, coming into this world, trying to bring truth into this world, it's frustrating. Very frustrating, because it just seems that people can't quite, you know, they have such a difficult time here. Such a difficult time. The spirit has such a difficult time reorienting here in this world. But it's only necessary to get to maybe. Getting to maybe here is a huge victory. Getting to maybe softens the entire situation out. And then the spiritual path can start, which is simply an accelerated practicing rehearsal, a rehearsal for happiness, a happiness rehearsal. The great good news is boundlessly happy. There's a boundless happiness. Total boundless happiness. Completely unagitated. Absolute stillness of unboundless happiness. Absolute stillness of unboundless happiness. So, that's way seeming like pie in the sky to being here in this world, it doesn't seem. But maybe, getting to maybe, saying maybe there is this absolute, unbounded, absolute stillness of unbounded happiness. Completely unperturbed happiness. Absolutely radiant, pure, clear happiness. Unbounded, totally free. Maybe there is. That is the huge step then. Rehearsal. That's all it is. It's that simple. You simply rehearse for happiness. Real happiness. Unbounded happiness. Not the happiness of, I'm bound to this form, you're bound to this form, let's be happy together with that. No. All is unbound. Spaciousness has absolutely zero preferences for any appearance whatsoever. It supports all appearances equally. So we are not bound. Nothing is bound. Nothing is bound. At all. Everything is absolutely free. Always. Everything is absolutely free. Always. Everything is absolutely free. Always. Now, there are those that come into the world who help others get to maybe. And they sometimes they have a very tough time here because they want to get everybody to maybe, and it doesn't necessarily happen that way here. Some get to maybe, and some say, no, I'm not ready for that. That's fine. So the overall situation is simply getting to maybe. And how do we get to maybe? We get to maybe by this is almost paradoxical. Because maybe is maybe. It's so there's elements of both in maybe. There's elements, you know, so it's not like a pure situation here. There's like, you don't see that happen here. You cannot, it's not, we're not trying to establish some sort of pure situation. It doesn't happen like that. So always in this world, there's a feeling of, well, maybe. Like, the situation is, the best you seem to see is like, well, maybe, maybe. But from that maybe, then the work happens from within. Your own motivation, the Holy Spirit, the grace of God, helps you build up, rehearse for the great good news. You'll see glimpses of the great good news, and you say, oh my gosh, I better prepare for that. What if that came to me, like, continuously? I'm not prepared for that. So you prepare inwardly, but externally, this world, the best it has is this feeling of, well, maybe. That's like the best I've seen. I'm trying to, just continuity problem. The continuity problem is the fear we have of, well, I'm not used to unbounded happiness. Complete freedom. Everything is totally unbound from any form whatsoever. There is no preferences for any particular form at all. And so this is such incredibly great news. We're not used to it. We're not familiar with that. So it's a familiarity continuity problem here that everybody has. So the way to look at it is constantly remind yourself, I don't have any problem except the continuity problem. I really don't. Everything is already free. But I'm not yet willing to feel that the tremendous great good news, the unbounded happiness. So I need to rehearse. In a very intelligent way. By listening to the Holy Spirit, I say, ask Holy Spirit, how do you want me to rehearse today? Always in the morning, Holy Spirit, how do you want my rehearsal to go today? Rehearsing for happiness, unbounded happiness, formless happiness. This world does not expect any unbounded happiness to appear here, because this world insists that a form, that spaciousness has preferences. So how can there be unbounded happiness? It doesn't seem possible. There's only this relative happiness. Between which bound form do I have, and how many other bound forms that can I get around that I like? And this sort of thing, spiritual duality, is what reigns here on this planet. As Jesus said, this is not my kingdom, this is the kingdom of darkness, the prince of darkness. Prince of spiritual duality dwells here, of saying, well, spaciousness does have preferences, most definitely. That's what they say, believe. It's only a matter of getting in a preferential place, finding the right preferences that will, having spaciousness bless you and say, well, my preference is for you is a good preference. And so we try to appease this spaciousness. We try to pray, appease, adjust, work, try to get ourselves in a more favorable preference of spaciousness. But that's spiritual duality. That's what reigns on this planet, this place, this density, this realm of density. But that's absolutely untrue. There's no truth to that whatsoever. There's zero preferences. God, pure spaciousness, the light, has zero preferences. Light is equally responsive to all requests. Spaciousness is equally welcoming and inclusive to all appearances, with absolutely no preference whatsoever. That is the truth. So you don't hear that here very often. I give all praise and thanks to Jesus Christ, who is the one that has imparted this information to me. I also give all praise and thanks to Longchenpa, the great Dzogchen teacher of Tibet, who gave me a great insight into this and experience of it, and supports this. I know he supports this entirely and understands it completely, perfectly. So, wow, I said, that's great. Great thanks to Sri Anandamayi Ma, who came here into the world and exemplified this fact that there's absolutely no preference of spaciousness has absolutely no preferences. Everything is completely perfect right now. Actually radiated this fact into the world to everyone here. Radiated this fact here. Ramana Maharshi, who just abided in this unbounded happiness, showing us, yes, you can. Yes, you can. It's here right now. Because this teaching does not easily get here. It's not. There's these pushes to get this here to what? To get us to maybe. To get us to maybe. Maybe is all important. So people should put an all-out sprint right now to get to maybe. To get to maybe. It is difficult to realize this unbounded happiness here in this world. It is difficult, for sure. Very difficult. The continuity problem is a collective continuity problem in this world. A collective continuity problem. It's not just my continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem I have. It's not just my continuity problem. It's the overall continuity problem. See, I don't have a world problem. I have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the only problem that I have. The problems of the world have absolutely no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. So the continuity problem is the only problem anyone has here. But it's a very severe problem. So the effort needs to be to get to maybe. Get to maybe. And that's difficult enough, for sure. Very difficult. Now, I got to maybe in 1978, as far as consciously. I lost in 1968. I kind of lost the capacity to get this news out in the world. When I was young, I had the capacity up to about 12 years old. I lost it for about 10 years, 1968, 1978. It was like a 10-year period there where I really, you know, had struggled very badly and made mistakes and compounded mistakes. Then in 1978, I had an awakening, and I got to maybe. I was able to reestablish this strong maybe, very strong maybe. And then A Course in Miracles from Jesus, I came into my life in 1978, and I've been able to expand upon that maybe and work on that maybe since then in a very intense way since 1978. It's like 36 years of extremely intense work. 1990s, and I saw her. I saw that this was an example of pure spaciousness, and it's totally free of all preferences, appearing in the world with a body to reassure us that pure spaciousness does not have any preferences whatsoever. All is equally loved. All is equally loved. And I said, wow. That really said it. It's doable here in this world, in these times. You see, these times are very heavy. Now we know that Jesus came into the world also as the pure spaciousness, the pure light that has, that has no preferences. Over 2,000 years ago. And that was a tremendous uplift to the world to help many get to maybe. Many get to maybe. Now, the skeptics here are mounting a massive assault on this maybe. The dark materialists here. Now, they're very clever. Dark materialists are very technically clever. Very sophisticated. Sophisticated materialists. They're not stupid in that way. They're mounting this massive front pressure against maybe to say, you guys are stupid. You know, you're not sure. We're sure. We're sure there's no way. You know, spaciousness definitely has preferences. We're sure about that. At least that's what they claim. They're bluffing, of course. They're not sure. But they're very good bluffers. So there's this massive campaign against maybe here. And it's having devastating effects on the world. Because those who are at maybe, they feel insecure and inferior in a lot of ways now. See, it used to be in the world, getting to maybe, realize that is really great. That is fantastic. That is absolutely fantastic, getting to maybe. And Jesus Christ coming to the world had a tremendous effect and help on this. Now, there have been others, too, who had a great help also. But we will use the example of Jesus Christ. There's no question that it had a tremendous effect in getting so many in this world to maybe. But maybe is still an ambivalent condition, isn't it? It's an insecure, ambivalent condition. However, you see light at the end of the tunnel. It's like you're in this dark tunnel, and you think, this is the preference that light, spaciousness has for me. Wow, I'm gonna have to learn to adjust to this dark tunnel. And then you look and you far, far in the distance, you think you catch a glimpse of light, and you say, whoa, whoa, what was that? And you say, wow, maybe there's a way out of this tunnel. And then you start crawling, slowly crawling towards where you thought you saw that light. So you're crawling. Because you're going towards this, what you're not sure, so you're hesitant and you have a continuity problem. You're used to the darkness. So you're crawling, grass slowly crawling towards what you think maybe is the light. I hope, I hope, I hope. So of course you're slow, you're hesitant, you seem timid, you seem meek, you know, uncertain. And now these spiritual materialists come into the world and they say, oh, there's no light at the end of the tunnel. What are you talking about? It's all darkness. It's all preferences. You know, it's just all a matter of getting what you want. You know, how do you get what you want? I'm going to insist, this is what I want. This is what I want. This is the preference I want. This is the preference. You know, I can make myself a nice, happy home here. Let's work on that. And so they're very brisk, very certain, very efficient. You know, and that, and so they seem very superior, very superior. So it's easy for them to bully the maybes. At least they think it's easy. They thought it would be easy. It's not quite working out for them that way. But that hasn't deterred them the slightest bit. Because from their viewpoint, the maybes here in this world are idiots. You know, they just view them as like, look at these idiots. Why are they crawling around, crawling so slowly when they could be standing on their feet and vigorously restructuring this world and let's work on these preferences. Let's get the right preferences and stuff, you know. They look down on them. They look down, they feel that they're aristocrats compared to the poor maybes, you know. And people say, you know, maybe Jesus is the way. Maybe the light is the way. What is Jesus? The light. What is the light? The light that holds no preferences. We can be anything we want to be. Any experience we want to experience. We're unbounded. We're absolutely free. And so we say, maybe we are that freedom. Maybe we are, quote unquote, Jesus Christ, the light of the world. Maybe we are the light of the world. Maybe we are the light of the world. Meaning, there is no preference whatsoever for this form or any form ever. There's no preference for, there's no preference against. And this news is so liberating. It's so liberating that we're not used to it. We're used to being in this tunnel of preferences, this dark tunnel of preferences. So we get bullied by these spiritual materialists, for sure. Now, I've been able to keep on trucking because of the great teachers that I have. I came across a new teacher recently, very determined, very hardworking teacher, very good example of dedication, determination, hard work, etc. Which is helpful for everyone. Every example of that is very helpful. Now, so the world can get used to those sort of teachers. A teacher like Sri Ananda Mayama is a different story. And she had to keep moving around because this is overwhelming for people. They can only take a little dosage of this absolute freedom, unbound freedom. All is absolutely perfect and overflowing with this assurance. Just, you know, cascades of blissful bliss. And so people are just like, whoa, that's, you know, I mean, for me, honestly, I don't know how much of that I could tolerate, or anyone could tolerate, actually. Nobody could actually tolerate it here. It's only a few could hang out, but even for them, it was just like, you know, too much. Those are super rare situations. Ramana Maharshi also, who could tolerate that? Not many. Maybe they'd sit at a distance, but it was just like, wow. Because there was no effort there at all. No effort at all whatsoever. Just 100% pure reassurance that all is free. All is free, all is free. Always. All is free, always. All is free, always. And she didn't even see bodies or forms in the way we do it always. Just saw the freedom. Absolute freedom. And so she was super blissful. Just, I mean, you come across that, that's a different story. Now, the teacher that I've come across recently is not like that. The teacher I've come across is a great worker on getting to this, so to speak, and setting an example is different, very different, very different, very different style. Sri Ananda, my ma, you just want to leap into freedom right away. Just whew, cast off this false belief, just like that. Now, of course, because of the continuity problem, people don't do that. So they kind of go, wow, whoa, wait a minute. It's too much. It's too much. Imitation is too strong. Imitation is too strong. The teacher that I've came across recently, the invitation is to work, which is great. The invitation is to get to work on this. And how to work on this was very good. Very good advice on how to work on the continuity problem. Very kind, gentle, quiet, how to work on this really. So that's very good, that's very good. And not many are willing to truly work on that. However, getting to maybe is the big deal. It's the big deal. Holding on to maybe at this time is the big deal. Is the big deal. So, if you're not getting to this, you know, ultimate liberation from false belief, which is all it is, false belief, that's okay. That's okay. I haven't gotten there yet. That's okay. It's the work ethic that's important. Getting to maybe and maintaining maybe, you need a great work ethic at this time to maintain that maybe. It is super important to maintain that maybe, which is why I'm very ecumenical, because there's many different ways to get to maybe, actually. There's not just one way to get to maybe. There is one truth, and that is that pure spaciousness, the light, God, the love, has no preferences for any appearance whatsoever. All is equally supported and included, with no preferences for or against whatsoever. That is the truth. And so it's also true that there are no preferences from pure spaciousness for any particular form of a teacher whatsoever. That is also absolutely true. Absolutely true. So we cannot get tripped up on that, you see. It's very important. I don't get tripped up on that. And I never have. Now, we may have our preferences for a particular teacher, which is perfectly fine, because remember, we're trying to get to maybe. So maybe does have preferences in that way. Maybe thinks maybe there are preferences. So I'm not against at all those who say this teacher is it. Not against that at all. Because it's super important to get to maybe, and getting to maybe usually entails that you believe that this teacher, this appearance, this is the one. You know, this is the one. You think this is the one true preference, you see. But that does get you to maybe somehow. It gets you to maybe because it sort of casts aside all their preferences, and then you're able to say, no, well, maybe there is this light, and maybe I need to go in this direction. So that is a stage of insisting that this must be the one true preference. Now, it's not true, but it does get to maybe. And from maybe, you then begin to be able to rehearse for the truth. You gotta crawl before you can walk. So I'm not against crawling at all. I'm absolutely pro crawling. I'm also pro walking. So I'm pro, you know, like that. And so some people, I don't know, I think I've most people have accepted that. For me, I don't have much pushback at all. It's always possible, but that's okay. But I am absolutely pro. There's this plurality inevitably arises. So on this planet we have different religions and different followings of people saying, hey, I think this is the God's preference, just this, nothing else. So at least they're getting to maybe, like maybe God only has one preference. Okay, it's better than saying that God has all these preferences. As monotheism is a positive progression from polytheism in terms of it's a complicated issue. There's another step past the monotheism, which is maybe pluralism, which is called. But to get to this true pluralism, you go through monotheism, actually. The true pluralism is working within some situation that's rehearsing for unbounded happiness. In some unique situation that for you is riveting and intriguing, whether your intrigue truly is there, that's genuine pluralism. In the past, it was, there's many, many, many gods and goddesses and that was a situation, it was the opposite. It was saying, God has all preferences, many, many preferences that for form, many, not just one, but many preferences. So that really, really, really binds you in darkness, times binds spirit in darkness. Because ultimately it goes to spiritual, humanism, secular humanism, which is every one of us is a preference of God. All forms are God's preferences. You know, that's the darkness. That's the heavy darkness. And you get there by the sort of heathen, pagan, polytheistic way, which is the world where the world is going in that direction. The flip side of that is enlightened pluralism, where you have various teachers all over who are simply helping you rehearse. And they may not emphasize any particular preference from God. You know, they didn't. You know, they may reference it occasionally, like that, but it's more about the continuity problem, working on it, rehearsing for happiness. That's what it's really about. And it's unbounded happiness. It's not the worshiping of a form, a preference of God, and saying, God, I know what your preferences are, because I'm worshiping your one preference. Okay. But it's better to be worshiping one preference than many preferences, okay? So we have a situation in the world where the darkness is trying to drag all the maybes down into many preferences, as God has many preferences. All these are preferences. And they say, no, I want to stay with God, just has one preference. And so there's a tremendous antagonism there, because those who pull themselves out of the hell of many preferences by this crutch of one preference, they don't want to go back down into many preferences. Absolutely not, they don't. And I certainly don't want them to either. So I absolutely support those who claim, well, you know, this preference of God is the only preference of God. Okay. I support that. Now, I support all there's various different, you know, factions in the world who claim that the one they follow is the sole preference of God. So I support all those. You know, and it's pretty difficult to come to someone and say, well, you know, how can you support that one preference when this is the one preference? I support the principle of worshiping one preference as a way of working on the continuity problem. Discarding the belief that God has many preferences is a huge step. Because that gets you to the point where you say, well, maybe God doesn't have any preferences. When you see the light, when you experience it, and you say, whoa. And then you're able to work with just one preference or not. You see, either there's one preference or there's none. one preference or none. You see, it's easy. None. We'll say, whoa, 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 that's too much of a continuity problem. It's easier to go for, well, maybe there's just one or none. It's either one or, you know, that's very simple, very simple. So you see, for instance, Christians being able to get to this unboundedness. For instance, the New Thought movement, which had a lot of really good teachings in it, it got co-opted, as it everything does in this world. It got co-opted, of course, but that came out of studying the Bible, out of believing that Jesus Christ is the sole preference of God. And this frees the mind up, this frees the attention up to take the next step. Monotheism frees the mind up to take the next step. Whether it's Buddhism, or whether it's Islam, whether it's Christianity, whether it's Hinduism, etc. Now, Hinduism tends to be very pluralistic. It's an interesting situation. But there's a lot of enlightened pluralism there too. Very interesting situation. Anyway. So at first people say Jesus is the way, Jesus is the sole preference of God for form. This is the form that we need to emulate and get on the good side of and pray to, and so that we get out of that preference. Jesus will tell us how to get on the right side of God's preferences, so to speak, and align with that. Okay, so that's a good step. And for a while, people just rest there. They want to rest there. They want to rest there. Now, with this rise of spiritual materialism in the world that wants to pull everything down into darkness, we're being challenged to take the next step. Being challenged to take the next step. Now, New Thought came along and was ultimately usurped in a lot of ways, turning towards a new institutionalization, but the high tide of that, you say, wow, you know, maybe we can, you know, take these steps away from believing that even God has even one preference for appearance and form. So it became sort of enlightened pluralism in some ways. It also got a lot of, well, there was a lot of attempts to usurp it, pull it down into the New World Order situation of institutionalizing. And I've gone into that in other videos. I'm not going to go into it here. So there is a progression that takes place. And then you're able to look at the Bible, for instance, and realize what Jesus was talking about, and you say, wow, I can see very clearly now. Now, Jesus told us that the Holy Spirit would come to us as the Comforter and explain everything that he was getting at, you see. And so the Holy Spirit has done that. And Jesus said, look, you don't understand me, really, yet. You want to make me king, you want to worship me, you want to put me on the throne here, you want me to unify the world, to destroy all your enemies, all this kind of stuff. You want to say that I am the sole preference of God, and I therefore we're morally justified in destroying all other preferences, and anyone who doesn't bow to me gets destroyed by the sword and all this. That's what they wanted. That's you know, the belief of that there's preferences. God has preferences. And he said, no. Turner said, no, that's not it. You don't get it, but the Holy Spirit will explain to you what my message really is, and you'll get it. And so he was right about that. Holy Spirit has explained it. So there's this battle going on for the maybes. You know, it's very important to maintain the maybe status at this point. But there's it's very tricky. It's somewhat tricky in the world right now, and you can all feel that. There's an attempt on the part of the spiritual materialists, children of darkness at this point, that they too will have to go through this, you know, process of awakening, a continuity process. They're not doing it right now. They'll have to do it later. They're trying to say that Jesus never existed, is what they're trying to do. So they're trying to undermine the maybes in that way. They're trying to undermine the maybes. You see, I absolutely insist that Jesus absolutely did exist. Jesus is absolutely present. He's helping us now. He's completely involved with the whole situation. Jesus lives today, absolutely. So my point is that the Holy Spirit is clarifying for us what the real teachings are, what the true teachings are. And this has been a process, for sure, a struggle, for sure, for all of us. It's a struggle for all of us. But the secular materialists, children of darkness, they want to reestablish a pluralism of preferences, leading to a complete polyglot of every form is a preference of God. That's what they're going towards. Super darkness. So they're trying to say that intermediate step of maybe is totally unjustified because there never was any Jesus. All this stuff is myths. There never was, you know, and that this light that you saw was just a hallucination. It's part of your brain. We can cure that and all this stuff. So they're ferociously trying to undermine the maybes here. Now, because that is happening, Jesus and those who are aligned with the same purpose, which are many, are working to elevate the maybe into actually working on the continuity problem more consciously. And it's called repentance. Trying to elevate repentance. It's called humility and repentance. So that you don't lose the maybe, and in fact, you go more towards the yes. You become more and more certain. So the efforts of the spiritual materialists, you know, water off a duck's back. Doesn't even, you don't even react to it, doesn't even bother you. Because they're saying, there is no light. You're just wasting your time going down that tunnel. It's all an hallucination. You're completely mistaken. There never was any Jesus in the world. It's all a myth. You're crazy. We have the treatment for you here. We have the drugs, the genetic splicing, manipulation. We'll do all these therapies on you. We'll cure you from your madness, and we'll make you very happy here. So they're ferociously pushing that. Now, of course, those who are insecure in their maybe are extremely angry and insecure about this. They're extremely angry about it. And so they're up in arms about it. And they think they need to defeat these spiritual materialists. You know, our preference is greater than your preference. And however, that's not the way. That is not the way. Jesus did say, resist not evil. Turn the other cheek, is there for a very good reason. Very good reason. So you could say that Jesus is the one preference that leads me out of preferences. You could say that. Now others could say, use other examples of that, right? Which for them is also fine, because God doesn't have any preferences, actually. But we need to go through that stage of this is the one preference that leads me out of all preferences. And then we eventually realize that the vision of oneness is what actually cures the continuity problem. And that's the vision of no preferences whatsoever. So those who are the spiritual materialists, children of darkness, are playing this tricky game of trying to say that it's a very tricky game. Because it can be viewed two ways. It can be viewed as a positive way and viewed as a negative way. As I see it playing out, it seems to be a very negative way, actually. They're trying to say that all these different spiritual leaders, Buddha, Jesus, etc., all this, many, they're saying, well, those are all good. So that, and you think, okay, that's an enlightened pluralism, right? Okay. However, what they do then is they start then dividing and conquering. They say, wait a minute. If God has all these different preferences and each one of these teachers is okay as a preference, then that must mean God has many preferences. You see what their conclusion is? Then it must mean that, well, your form must be a preference of God too, right? And so there's this whole hierarchy of preferences that gets instituted, which leads to this bureaucracy, which leads to this dictatorship with this massive, which leads to the New World Order. So they play a very tricky game with this. Now, I am not sure if that was the intention of those who were teaching enlightened pluralism. It may have been usurped in a lot of ways. So this is something that is yet to be determined entirely. Because an enlightened pluralism, like for me, ecumenical, true ecumenical, universal ecumenical outlook, is I understand that because of the uniqueness, the belief in preferences leads to a sense of uniqueness and specialness, very strong. And because that specialness and uniqueness is there, the only certain situations that will seem to lead to maybe. And so they will see a certain teacher who is actually, who's awake, realizing there are no preferences. They'll see them as special, as the one preference of God, and they won't see another one that way. So that inevitably happens. So it is true that this takes place, but is it really necessary to set up this global New World Order that puts all these enlightened teachers and saying, these are the preferences of God, let's be pluralistic here and see that God has many preferences? That's wrong. That's wrong, in my opinion. In my opinion. Now, others may have other opinions about that. There's a very slippery slope there. It's very exploitable, isn't it? And the New World Order has been exploiting this. I don't know if that was the intentions, for instance, of Theosophy and the New Thought and all these movements. I don't know if that was necessarily their intention. But it certainly can be a very slippery slope. So one could also say it's better to stay within your tradition. Okay, it's better to stay within your tradition. And those who are truly ecumenical, because they've been able to truly see this, you don't have to be that way at any particular point. Now Anandamayi Ma said, stick with your tradition. Okay, so there's an enlightened advice right there. She said, stick with your tradition. Don't try to be this super ecumenical person. Like Ramakrishna in Vivekananda, you know, tried to present this great ecumenicalness of like all approaches are great. You can do anyone you want. Is so, and that's sort of Srinanda Maimai did not go that direction. Saying, she said, "What is your tradition?" Someone came to her and said, "What is your tradition?" They'd say, "Well, I'm Christian. I'm Hindu. I'm Buddhist. I'm Zoroastrian. I'm Jainism. I'm Islam. I'm Jewish. What's your tradition?" The Jewish tradition. I don't know, you could call it Judaism. And she'd say, "Okay, great. Stick with that tradition. Stick with that tradition." And from within that tradition, work on your continuity problem, essentially. Work on your continuity problem from within that tradition. And don't worry about anything else. You just keep working on that continuity problem. Now, there are others who have done a lot of work on the continuity problem, and they don't feel such a strong need to identify with any tradition. But that does not mean that they are looking down on traditions. It does not mean that they're promoting many traditions. They're not necessarily promoting this new world order of many preferences of God. It's different. They're saying there are many instances of one preference from factions. That's fine. Factionalism is fine. That will stay within your faction, work on the continuity problem. Eventually, you will begin to realize that there are no preferences of God. The great good news, the more you work on your continuity problem, the easier it is to accept this great good news. And then you say God has no preferences. That's very different than saying God has many preferences. And you'll see it's very true. Like the very form, like of Srinanda Maima, God had no preference for that form. Absolutely none. None for, none against, whatsoever. And she made clear that this was so because she showed no preference for her form whatsoever, one way or the other. No identification with it. So, there are all sorts of gradations along the way. All of those can be exploited. And all of those are exploited by the spiritual materialists. For instance, Srinanda Maima was very difficult to exploit, and that's why you really don't hear much about her. And it seemed to be just disappearing, you know, just very, because nobody could really exploit her. Exploit that. Nobody could set up, say, "You're the preference." You know, "You're the preference." I tried to do that. I say, you're the preference. We need at least one really great preference. But It's not true. Because people are yearning, like, "I just need, you know, just one really great preference, I'll be happy." But what she's shown us, no, God has no preferences. That's the happiness. So ultimately we have no choice but to keep marching on from with our maybe in hand towards the light. We have no choice. And the spiritual materialists are really, in some ways, here to help us because there's such a pain. There's such a thorn in the side that they're forcing us to march forward to real realization of no preferences. They're forcing that. But what a headache it is to deal with the situation and all the different stratifications. But everybody reacts in a different way depending on their stratification. What I try to do is give an overview of this whole situation, which is in itself light, because And I think people listening to this, they'll get a glimmer and say, wait, maybe I'm not completely stuck here. Because actually, having one preference right now is hell on this planet, isn't it? It's hell. I mean, these spiritual materials are making it hell. And it's divide and conquer. They're, you can see that they're pushing this, say, hey, he has a, you know, he has a preference that he thinks that's the one God prefers. You over here, you know, hey, you have your preference. He's disagreeing with your preference. And they try to generate conflict between factions in this world, is what they do, to try to tear the whole thing down. And then to get back to their, you know, heathen and paganism of like, all forms are God's preferences. That's very different than saying all forms are completely free of God's preference. God holds no preference for or against any form. All is equally loved and inclusive. Different situation, but sometimes it's easy to get the two confused. The pagans say, no, every form that appears is because God says, this is the form I want to have appear. This is it. This is my preference. And they think that they're living in heaven, that this world can be heaven, because they think it represents God's preferences, and they think we just need to be here and live here and accept this as God's preference, and then we'll be, you know, paradise. That's the opposite of truth. God has absolutely no preferences for, we're completely free. God created freedom. And that is paradise. And it's universal freedom. All God's creation, the creation of freedom, is free. Free to experience and play with all experiences and plays without any exception. So Jesus came back here at the end of the age to give an update. He says, how you all doing here? You know, just let me show you what the bar is here, so you know, you got to keep pushing here. Got to keep pushing. So A Course in Miracles came in, you know, 19... I think the Criswell edition, what was it, in 76 or something, and then 78 was published, I think, to the public more, subsequent publishings. It came in at a time, gave us a little time to be able to withstand the spiritual materialism that was coming into the world. They know, Holy Spirit knows what's coming. So it gave us this tremendous boost, which was essential. The polytheistic, all forms of preferences of God is not true. It's a spurious, specious teaching. But it's very attractive to many people. Because you think, well, if God has no preferences, then God does prefer the form I have now. But that is not true. That is not true. No preferences mean no preferences. God both loves all appearances that appear and also all appearances that don't appear. In other words, absolutely no preference, total love, just as it is. Always just love as it is. That does not mean that, see, this is the tricky part, that where the pagans, you know, stumble. It does not mean that God chose this preference for you. It does not mean that everything here in this world is God's preference. That is, it does not mean that. Now, this is the tricky part. It both is and it isn't. You see, it both is and it isn't. And neither is nor isn't. So it's not this polytheistic paganism of this is God's choice for me. Or this is the preference God wants me to have. God is not like that. Being completely supportive and inclusive of all. See, it's inclusive of all. So you cannot say that this form is exactly what God wants for me, the preference that God has for me. God does not hold preferences for us. It's simply what I'm choosing at this moment. Not what God is choosing for me, what I am choosing. But I am completely free. Because I am as God created me. I am not a body. I am completely free. For I am as God created me. So the continuity fear makes it very tricky for us, because polytheism can seem to be very attractive because of our continuity fear. See, our continuity fear, polytheism seems to limit our happiness intrinsically. It's saying, God is saying, this is where your happiness is, with this form and this form. I've chosen this happiness for you. And so it makes the happiness little, it limits it. And so we feel safe, and we think our continuity problem is solved that way. So this is the insidious nature of our problem. Our continuity problem is so severe, we're so desperate to have it solved, that we easily accept these limitations, a religion of limitation, of saying, these are the preferences God has chosen for you, and therefore this is where your happiness is. We easily go toward that as backsliding. So what I say, you know, what the Holy Spirit has given me is the repentance. We must repent and say, I have an extremely severe continuity problem, extremely severe. And to acknowledge that, and that protects you from this backsliding into polytheism, polytheistic paganism, which is reassuring you that your happiness is limited. Don't worry, your happiness is limited, perpetually limited, which is the false doctrine, the false teaching, it's the false light. It's the false light that seems so attractive to us. So the protection from that false light that seems so attractive to us is repentance, humility. Say, I have a very severe continuity problem. And so I know I'm going to be attracted to the false light. I know that's not right. I know I need to sit quietly and not allow that to happen. I know it's going to be, I'm going to stumble along, you see. And I know I'm looking at those people who accept polytheistic paganism, who seem so happy and well-adjusted, and it's like, wow. And I know that I look like I'm an idiot, and I don't get it into their eyes. But it's because of the severity of my continuity problem that I feel this way. And so I just need to keep going towards the light and realize that it's a struggle. See, because these others, it seems like they've solved the continuity problem. Hey, this is it. This is my home, they say. This world, these forms, everything, this is the home. God has made this home for us. This is our home. So we don't have any continuity problem. We're home. And we'll just get whatever happiness we can out of these forms. It's very attractive in a spurious way, because of our severity of our continuity problem. We just think, I'm so scared of this unbounded happiness. Can I not settle for just a little, you know, little happiness? And no. The problem of these times is the secular materialists who are so clever coming in this world now, they're producing such massive amounts of things, okay? And so we're saying, wow, look what God's doing for us. God loves us so much, he's God's enabling many, many, many things to be produced so I can be happy in this world. Limited happiness, but look at so many bright, shiny things for me. You know? You got these massive manufacturing centers like China, you know, Japan, Korea, United States, various places, Europe, you know, the whole world. But China's really pumping out the stuff for sure, right? Everything you look at, made in China. Look at all this stuff. Of course, here we're furious with this stuff because everything breaks. Get it out of the box and it breaks. It doesn't last. It's cheap, flimsy. And you have to keep spending money. If I buy something, I want it to last for the rest of my life. I spend $10. Yeah, I used to buy, like, for instance, people buy a cigarette lighter or a lighter. That thing was built to last, you know, 40 years or something. I mean, just refill it. It lasts almost forever. Stuff you get now, you know, you throw away in a month. Just throw it away. It's crazy. Terrible. We're in this disposable culture. Everything's throwaway culture. But that's what people want to be happy. You see, within, they still want their freedom. So what happens when they accept this limited happiness of God chose all this for us, this is it. But they just keep a lot quantity of it. You know, throw away this, so I get something new. Okay, good. So that feels to them like freedom. I'm free to buy something else. I'm free to buy something else. Of course, there's limited resources. There's limited money. How much money do you have? You got to work hard for it. So it's a hellish kind of cycle. This realm of secular materialism, New World Order, is a hellish situation, actually. But for many, it seems to be this is it. Constantly upgrading your gadgets, you know, it's just hell, absolute hell. All the new ones out. Oh, I need to update this. Oh, that system is not so good anymore. It doesn't work anymore. But this is the new one. This is like this frantic pressure on everybody. Oh, these are the new clothes. Oh, those clothes? No. That's not it. This is the new preference. So you get in this terrible cycle of chasing after happiness through form, and insisting, oh, this is the new preference. And then you fall into this bureaucratic, materialistic dictatorship of the New World Order, which streamlines all this and says, don't worry, we'll keep you up to date on what the new preferences are. We'll tell you what they are. And so they become like God to you, and you worship this Moloch, this little whore of Babylon is what you end up worshiping, actually. This. Now, we've been warned about all this, but that doesn't make it any easier, really, a little bit, but it's still incredibly tough. So, humility is what works. You know, Jesus says that if the world hates you, remember that it hated me first. That's telling you humility. Meaning, remember, the world looked at Jesus and said, Jesus, you're nothing. We're going to kill you. You know, that's how much the world hated Jesus. The secular materialists hated Jesus that much. So, to them, he was this worthless person who had no value whatsoever and didn't get it and never would get it. They look at Jesus and say, you know what? You're never going to get it. That their God has preferences. You're never going to get that. So we're going to have to do away with you. So as we struggle here from any background, actually, no matter what you're seeing as God's preference, it's all the same struggle. It's all the same dynamics here for everyone. You will feel inferior here. You will feel rejected by the world, by secular materialism. You will feel that they look at you as stupid, that you're incapable of moving with the times. See, having preferences intrinsically, as far as being dictated to, as far as, you know, God telling us this is what we have to do, as far as that goes, we can't stand that feeling. We wouldn't say no, because we're created free. So when we accept preferences and say, okay, God's insisting on these preferences, we want to keep getting new preferences, because the old feels like we associate this feeling of dislike that we have with the situation with the old preferences. So out with the old, in with the new becomes the religion. Out with the old, in with the new. So everything's disposable. And these secular materialists, really, they want to get rid of the older people on this planet, as a matter of fact. That's how deep it goes. Get rid of them. Out with the old, in with the new. That is the religion. Like for me, it's very different. I seem to be happy, or content, or it doesn't bother me. I've lived in the exact, you know, same place for like 50 years. Everything looks exactly the same. I don't go anywhere, I don't do anything. It doesn't really affect me very much. The stuff I want, you know, as far as material stuff, I'd like to have something my whole life, the same silverware, the same plates, the same pans. I'd even be happy the same car. For me, I'd be happy to have the same furniture, everything, my entire life without changing it. Doesn't bother me. Doesn't bother me. Because that makes it a lot easier to then work on this continuity problem. A lot easier. Whereas if you're constantly chasing after the new, out with the old, in with the new, out with the old, in with the new, this secular consumerism, secular materialistic consumerism, which is the religion of the New World Order, you're never going to focus on the continuity problem. You're never going to do the work. Now, this does not need to be some kind of autocratic demand that everything be the same. I mean, sometimes I'll get something new, but it's, you know, it's the craving is not really there like it used to be. Like I try to get classic shirts. I said, I'm happy to wear this shirt my whole life. That's how I feel. I get these linen shirts that are, I want them to last a long time. So if it lasts, you know, 50 years, I'm still wearing the same shirt for 40 years or what, that's fine with me. It's not a problem really. You just get classic, timeless stuff. That's it. That is a way superior culture to this disposable throwaway culture that we have now. Way superior. Although it can be argued. See, this is always can be argued in a specious way. Like, no, you're just getting used to your more freedom, more freedom, more freedom. But not really. You're getting addicted to functioning in the realm of preferences, in the belief of preferences, which leads to, like the astral realm, it leads to the false light realms, which there are realms of the false light, which seem very pleasant, and you seem to be flowing through all sorts of stuff, but you have not awakened to the truth, and it's a compensation. It say, well, it's tricky. The whole dream, the whole thing is tricky, actually. It can seem like you're getting free of preferences by just flowing through a whole bunch of preferences quickly, fast. But in my own life, I've seen that doesn't work, actually. It doesn't work. You think it should work. Because you say, no, I don't have any preferences because I'm getting new preferences. I'm discarding all these preferences. I'm discarding. But at the same hand, you're pulling in a whole bunch of new preferences. So you think you're, that spiritual is called spiritual dualism, which is a very tricky situation. The world, as I say, spiritually dualistic here. It's deception. It's the false light. And there is a realm above this world of the false light. So it's easy to give the appearance that you're spiritual and free of preferences when you're discarding all bunch of preferences. I don't have any preferences for this stuff. But you did. So, yeah, but I'm freeing myself from the preferences that I had, you see. I don't have any preferences. However, through the other hand, you're pulling in a whole new set of preferences, saying, "Yeah, this is the, these are the preferences." This is where most get stuck and got. Now, like traveling, for instance, you may think you're free. You say, "I'm unbound. I don't have a home. I'm traveling all the place." Always in the rearview mirror saying, look at all the stuff I'm leaving behind. I'm really leaving it all behind. And yet, in front of you is all the stuff that you say, oh, I'm attracted to this. Look at these preferences. Yeah, these are the ones. And at the same hand, you're saying, no, I'm leaving all that behind. I'm very spiritual. And so you can end up like in a perpetual traveling mode of just constantly need to go somewhere new, go somewhere new, go somewhere new to maintain my belief that I'm very spiritual. The spiritual dualism. spiritual dualism is a very tricky thing. And we're all stuck in it in some way. I certainly have been tricked by this to some degree. And I've seen many that have been tricked by this.